Good morning and welcome. Thank you for joining with us, and I pray that as we meet together today, we will be aware of the Lord's presence, aware of God's Spirit with us wherever we are worshiping today. And as we come together on this Father's Day, some words from Psalm 28. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and he helps me. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and he helps me. Let us pray. Father, as we come together today, may we truly know you as the Lord of our lives. May we know you as our strength, our shield. May our hearts trust in you. May we trust in you with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And may we know your help, your encouragement, your guidance, the empowering presence of your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Where streams of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
As we worship the Lord together today, let's confess our sins to him. Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. And may Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then the collect, the prayer for this Sunday. God, the strength of all those who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers. And because through the weakness of our mortal nature, we can do no good thing without you, grant us the help of your grace, that in the keeping of your commandments, we may please you both in will and deed, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The 19th chapter of the first book of Kings, beginning at the first verse. Now Ahab told Jezebel everything Elijah had done, and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, "May the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them." Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there, while he himself went a day's journey into the desert. He came to a broom tree, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. "I have had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the tree and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and there by his head was a cake of bread, baked over hot coals, and a jar of water. He ate and drank, and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he travelled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. And the word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came, and go to the desert of Damascus." This is the word of our Lord.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we come to study it now, may your word be our rule, your spirit our guide, and your greater glory our supreme concern, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, on Father's Day, we celebrate our dads and all those men who are father figures to us. We give thanks for all that they do and for their love and care for us, because we all need people to look after us. From the moment we are born, we have basic needs that must be met. We need food, water, warmth, rest, love, and attention. When babies cry, it's often because one of these things is required. They need fed, or they need sleep, or they need attention. Although we hopefully change how we express it, even as adults, our mood changes when our basic needs aren't being met, when we're hungry, when we're tired, when we need people, or even when we need a break from people. If our parents and those closest to us can immediately sense that mood change and know that we are in some form of need, then Scripture today invites us to see how much more our Heavenly Father knows our need and meets us at our point of deepest need. Today we're in 1 Kings, the book which chronicles a long line of the kings of Israel who follow David, but none of them can live up to his reign. There has been a promise of a son of David, a Messiah, a great king. But as we travel through the book of Kings, this greater king has yet to come. The true king is still hoped and longed for, and things aren't going well in the meantime. In chapter 19, we're under the rule of King Ahab. And if we look back to chapter 16, we find out just how bad things are under his rule and reign. We're told that King Ahab did more evil in the eyes of the Lord than any of those before him. In a series of bad kings, King Ahab is the worst. He marries a Canaanite woman called Jezebel. He commits the sins of those kings who came before him and worse. And he begins to serve false gods and to worship them. He institutes worship of these false gods for the whole northern kingdom of Israel. And this is when Elijah the prophet comes on the scene. The kingdom of Israel, the chosen people of God, have fallen away from their true purpose. So Elijah's service as a prophet is neither easy nor straightforward. As God's prophets were called to do, Elijah calls out injustice and false worship, and he recalls people back to true worship of the one true God. He reveals the falseness of the gods of Baal, and as Elijah carries out his work, the God of Israel powerfully reveals himself to be the only one worthy of worship. As Elijah carries out this difficult ministry at a difficult time in the history of Israel, he learns what it means to depend on God for all his basic needs. As he hears and obeys the word of the Lord, all his needs are met. As Elijah is faithful to his call, the Lord is faithful to him. The Lord provides for him, and Elijah is fed by ravens, led by brooks of water, has bread made for him by a widow at just the right time. The Lord provides for his people. But when we meet Elijah today in 1 Kings chapter 19, we see a man at the end of his own strength. He's worn out, burnt out, discouraged, and afraid of what might come next. His basic needs are not being met. He's afraid, he's tired, he's hungry and alone. This discouraged prophet flees to the wilderness. Elijah is literally running for his life, but he's so deeply discouraged, his despair is so great, that as he sits under a broom bush in the middle of nowhere, he prays and says, "I have had enough, Lord." With Elijah's limited human vision, he's only able to see his immediate failures. He can only see the continued faithlessness of Israel. Elijah is unable to see a way forward. He's unable to see how things could possibly get better. Elijah cannot see how the chosen people of the Lord can find their way back. He's unable to see how he, as a prophet, has been any more successful than those who have come before him. And all of this, despite all the wonders that God has worked for him and through him. In Elijah's mind, his ministry as a prophet of the Lord has been a failure. His sense of despair is made all the worse by his feeling that he has given his all to the cause to which he was called. His tank is empty. This discouraged prophet feels like he has no more to give. In verse 10, he says, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty." Elijah has been faithful, passionate about his work, passionate about the Lord, but despite his faithfulness, all Elijah can see is failure. The Israelites persist in rejecting God's covenant. They are faithless despite God's faithfulness. They have torn down altars to the Lord despite the wonders they have seen God work throughout history. They have put prophets of the Lord to death despite how they have heard prophets speak his words. And now only Elijah remains. But his life is in danger, his strength is gone, and his heart is no longer in it. But as Elijah, this discouraged prophet, sits in the depths of despair, heavy-hearted and wearied, all at once he is interrupted. Though Elijah can't bring himself to work anymore, the Lord is still at work providing for his people. An angel who is a messenger of the Lord touches him and invites him to eat. Elijah looks and sees that once again the Lord has provided for his basic needs. There is bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. This has been the pattern of Elijah's whole ministry. God has provided for him. And even now, as he retreats to the desert, the Lord continues to provide. But it turns out that a snack and a nap can't fix everything. Maybe they can fix some things. It turns out, though, that our basic needs are more than food, water, and rest. Our deepest need is the presence of our Heavenly Father. So after Elijah eats and drinks for a second time, he sets out and travels 40 days and 40 nights until he reaches Horeb, the mountain of God, that place of such significance in the story of Israel. On this mountain, God makes himself known to humanity. On this mountain, the perfect God communes with imperfect people and reaches out to them in perfect love. Here on the mountain, God spoke with Moses. Here, water sprang forth from a rock to quench the thirst of desert-wandering Israelites. Here, God provided the commandments to guide his people on paths of righteousness. And here on the mountain, a gentle father ministers to his discouraged prophet. Elijah responds to the Lord and explains why he is sleeping here on the mountain. He's stuck in a loop of discouragement. He repeats what he has already said. But the Lord does not respond by telling him to shake himself. He doesn't rebuke him for his faithlessness. He doesn't tell him to just get up and get on with things. God graciously responds by inviting him to experience the very presence of the Lord. There is a powerful wind. There is a great earthquake. There is a fire. But the Lord is not in these huge forces of nature. Our gentle Father makes himself known in a gentle whisper. But the power of this tiny, still voice, the power of this whisper, is awe-inspiring, breathtaking. The glory of the Lord is overwhelming. The holiness of the Lord is too perfect, but his gentleness is welcoming. His grace is sufficient. So Elijah, aware of his unworthiness in the presence of the one true God, Elijah covers his face with his cloak and soaks in the presence of the God who pours out his extravagant and refreshing grace. It's with gentleness that the Lord asks what is wrong. It's with grace that the Lord invites into his presence. And it's with love that the Lord sends Elijah back the way he came to anoint new kings and a new prophet. This is where we finished reading in verse 15 with the mention of more kings to come and more prophets called to hold them accountable. But the pattern of the book of Kings will continue and persist, a faithful God calling imperfect prophets to recall imperfect and faithless people back to the gentle embrace of the God who perfectly loves the people he has made. But the one true king has yet to come at this point in the history of Israel. But we know that greater things will come. The fullness of Scripture reveals to us that King Jesus has come, and he will one day come again to bring the fullness of the kingdom just as he promised. In King Jesus, God provides for our deepest needs. The bread of life has come from heaven in order that we might have fullness of life forever. This gentle King, this humble Savior, reveals the depths of God's love for us, brings us into the fullness of God's presence where we find fullness of life. Our gentle Saviour invites us to rest in him as we respond today to the still small voice, which calls to us even now to have faith in the King who came to bring us into his eternal kingdom. Jesus promises to carry the burdens of those who are heavy burdened. Jesus calls his people not to let their hearts be troubled. Jesus reveals the love of the Father for his people. Jesus makes a way back into the loving embrace of the Father. This relationship, intimately dwelling with and abiding in our Father's love through faith in the Son, this relationship is what we were made for. The still, small voice, the gentle whisper that Elijah once heard, still speaks today and now invites us to put our faith and trust in the one who made a way for us to dwell in the presence of God. If today you find yourself in the same situation as Elijah, at the end of your own strength, hear the voice of the Father, gently calling you to come into his presence through faith in the Son. If today you have drifted far from God into the wilderness, hear the gentle voice of the Father calling you home. If today your heart is restless and you don't know why, hear the gentle voice of the Father calling you to find your rest in him. In the worries, in the challenges, in the joys, in the ordinary moments of everyday life, pause and attend to the still small voice, the gentle whisper of the Lord, in whose presence alone we find true purpose, deep rest, true and everlasting love, and fullness of joy. Amen.
Glory.
Let us pray. Father, we praise you for every experience we have of your loving care. We are so grateful that you are a good, good Father who loves us. We thank you for Jesus Christ, your Son, who came to declare and demonstrate your love in his earthly life and in his death and resurrection. We thank you for the life-giving and life-transforming power of the Holy Spirit. On this Father's Day, we thank you for our fathers and pray for all who have the privilege and responsibility of caring for and nurturing children. Guide and help all parents and all people who are struggling with pressures and burdens. May they know the love and support of others. Give them courage and hope. And where Father's Day brings disappointment, pain or sadness, we pray for comfort, encouragement, healing and peace. Father, enfold us in your love and give us an awareness that you care for us. Father, we pray for all in authority, for Her Majesty the Queen, for presidents and for prime ministers, and for all in positions of political power and influence, and all whose decisions affect the lives of others. Help them to lead with honour and integrity, with compassion and consideration for others. We continue to pray for Ukraine and other places where people experience tragedy, turmoil, or trouble. Protect and provide. Thwart the plans and designs of aggressors and all who seek to exploit, oppress, hurt, or harm others. Father, we pray for those who are ill in body, mind, or spirit. For those who are living with doubt, disappointment, or depression. For those who are grieving, for those who are vulnerable or in need, for those who are uncertain about their future, unsure about the way ahead, grant healing, comfort, guidance, encouragement, renewal and hope. And in a moment of quiet, we bring our own thanksgivings and requests to God our Father. And we gather all our prayers together as we join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And the blessing. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may we know the presence and power of God's Spirit at work in our lives. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with us and remain with us this day and forevermore. Amen. And then just in terms of announcements, to remind you of our church walk and barbecue this coming Saturday at 2:30 at Kilbroney. Please do let us know you're coming. There's information to sign up on the website and Facebook or contact the office. So that's this coming Saturday at 2:30 at Kilbroney. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you until we meet again.